Hello and welcome to another edition of History Science Fiber. My name is Zoe McDonald. I'm a biologist, and today we are going to be dyeing with a Boletopsis, this time with Boletopsis grisea. Come join me. To start off with, I want to acknowledge that I could not be doing this video without the teachings of two amazing master mushroom dyers, Alyssa Allens here on the West Coast and Susan Hopkins over on the East Coast. Both of them are truly master mushroom dyers, and I've learned so much. So I couldn't have done this without those two ladies. And if you ever get a chance to do a workshop from them, I would definitely take it. Boletopsis is an interesting genus. It is actually not a bolete. It is in the Thelephoroid clade. So it is in with mushrooms like sarcodon, which is this one here. It's seen better days, but you can see it has some scales up top that have had a secondary mushroom, and then it has those spines underneath. So that's sarcodon. It's also in the same clade as the hydnellums. I'll do another class on the hydnellums. This is a hydnellum here. You can see that it has those teeth underneath, and even polyozoellus multiplex, which is one we've already dyed with on this channel. So it's in with those ones. We're gonna treat it in the similar ways as we would treat the hydnellums. But I managed to get a whole bunch of fresh Boletopsis grisea. So that's what we'll be going with. And they vary in size. The caps are generally between 4 to about 20 centimeters, so even larger than this one. They're circular, but also irregular. They can be planar or they can be slightly convex. They can decurve at the edges, and they come in a wide variety of colors. They can be white. I have one, there you go. So while it's dark on the outside, you can see that it's light. And so it really doesn't seem like it's gonna be a very good dyer, but I'm gonna show you some tricks to get color out of this one. So another question we might get is, where do you find these? So they can be in mixed woods or coniferous woods. They often require mature old growth. Some consider them to be an indication of a healthy old growth forest. They grow singularly, or they can grow in a group. But yeah, I would consider them, if you've got a really healthy forest, and they're found in slightly different habitats here on the West Coast, and they're also found on the East Coast. So Beth, if you are looking for this mushroom, if you get inspired by the video and want to know more about it, I would reach out to your local mushroom group. So the first thing we want to do is weigh our mushrooms. I'm just going to tear the bowl, bring it back down to zero, and I'm going to add my mushrooms. And that will tell us how much they weigh. And then later on, we can do some calculations for our yarn. Okay, so we have 402 grams of mushrooms. So one of the first things we're gonna do is actually chop up these mushrooms as finely as we can. We always wanna maximize our surface area. So we're gonna chop them up really, really finely, as fine as we can. One thing I wanted to mention before we start chopping is that any of the equipment that we use are separate from our food. So this is a chopping board and a knife I just used for mushrooms. We need to make sure that any of the equipment and the mushrooms are not food safe and should not be mixed with your cooking equipment. Next step is heating up the mushroom for an hour, and we want to do that in our mushroom pot. So you can just add the mushrooms, the water, heat it, and then add your fiber. But what that can do is introduce sort of bits and pieces that stick with your fiber. So adding a barrier is very helpful. There's different ways to do it. You can use cheesecloth. You can also decant one pot into another through a strainer. This is Alyssa Allen's trick, and I love it. This is just a paint bag. They're available from the paint store. There's similar ones you can get. Like, I've seen people use grocery produce bags as well, like those reusable ones. But these ones are also reusable. They're fairly inexpensive. They're a couple bucks. This is the 5-gallon size. And as you can see, it just kind of fits over the top. And what that allows us to do is, I've got the mushrooms right here, here's our Boletopsis, is we can add it in And then we're gonna add water, and then we're gonna talk about the pH in a second. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna add water, then we're gonna heat it on the stove for an hour. And then when it's done, we can take the bag and the mushroom out together. And that allows us to have a beautiful dye pot with our fiber right in. So when it comes to temperature, it doesn't really matter what temperature. We're never gonna wanna boil these mushrooms. We wanna keep it below Fahrenheit, below 180. We want it to be about 160 for an hour. 160 is about, I want to say 70 degrees Celsius. Hopefully I've got that right. This is not a dye that needs a high heat, and definitely you want it sort of a little bit below a simmer and not a boil. If you do boil it, you can lose, those dye pigments will denature and be destroyed. So here we go. Okay, we're gonna talk about pH. pH is how acidic or basic something is. And to dye with this mushroom, you wanna increase its alkalinity. You wanna boost the number. Our tap water, which is what I use here, is usually between a 6 and a 7. This is our pH paper. We want this mushroom to sit at about a 9. The higher up it goes, it's not gonna change the color, but it will be super hard on the yarn. So if you dye at about 11, it can make your yarn very friable and breakable, so you can knit yourself a sweater and the sweater can degrade. So you really wanna have it sit at about a 9. So what we're gonna do is something I'm just recently incorporated into my dye, which is buffering. Buffering is when, we're gonna do it rather crudely at home, we're gonna add some vinegar, and what that's gonna do is create an acidic environment, and then we're gonna increase the alkalinity. And having acidic and basic ions will allow us to zero in better, make our pH more accurate, and maintain it. As you put different things in and put the yarn in, the pH can start creeping down, but buffering should allow it to be maintained. So I'm gonna add about a tablespoon of vinegar, which is gonna create a base or a acidic environment. And then we're gonna add washing soda. So when you're dyeing and you wanna increase your pH, a lot of dyers use ammonia. I find it affects my lungs. And so I tend to use a powder called washing soda. And when you do use washing soda and you're using pH paper to check what your pH is at, give it a couple of minutes to stabilize, because it doesn't change it as quick as using ammonia, but it really is just as good in my opinion. Okay, let's get started on this next step. Down to about a 4, and then let's add that washing soda. So there we go. There we go. So we got it at a 9 to 10. So great, leave it there and let this heat for an hour. I'm not gonna go too far into the mordanting side. I covered that in an earlier video on acorns dying, and I can put that in the description below, a link to that. But we're gonna do three different yarns that were mordanted. So mordant is just introducing your yarn to a metal salt before you dye, and that allows you to change the color. And I've, as you can see, I've put zip ties. This was another trick I learned from Alyssa Allen's. Because obviously your yarn is gonna change color in the pot, and you're not quite sure which one gives you which color. If you have a zip tie ahead of time, you can see exactly what it was. In this case, blue means this is unmordanted. This is just natural yarn. Green means this is alum mordanted at 16%. And then this is iron mordanted, the purple one, at 6%. Ferrous sulfate. So those are already done ahead of time. If you want more information, check out that earlier video. At this stage, we're gonna soak them in just in water, and then just soaking them and getting them moist before dipping them just allows for them to soak right into the dye pot. So let's get started. And then I usually just use room temperature, and I soak the iron ones separately. And then just make sure you soak them for about 20 minutes. We've now heated this for an hour. I rechecked the pH, it had dropped down to about an 8, and I added about a quarter teaspoon of washing soda, which got it back up to a 10. So I'm going to add the yarn. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna pull the bag aside, and as you can see, now there's no pieces. We'll add the yarn, and then we'll put the bag back on just to really maximize every bit of the mushroom dye. So I have this yarn just soaking off camera in these jars. The blue, this is the non-mordanted. So I'm just gonna give it a squeeze. So it's just, I'm a little bit wet, and then I'm gonna put it in. The next one I'm gonna put in is the alum mordanted. That's the one that has the green. Make sure that's all squeezed out. Add that in. In it goes, and finally the iron, which has been soaking separately. And in the iron goes. So there we go, we have our three. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna put the bag back on and on top of the yarn. And then we're gonna heat for another hour and have a look. Try to make sure that yarn is below the surface. The other thing you want to do when you want to, in this case, I'm bringing something, the yarn is room temperature, and I'm putting it into something hot. Normally you'd want to avoid that for these small sort of sample skeins. It's not a huge deal, but if I was dying for a bigger project, I would have allowed this bath to cool down to room temperature and then added the yarn and then heated it back up. And I check it about every 10 minutes or so and just give it a gentle agitation, nice and soft movements, nothing too bad to, because we don't want that yarn to felt. Okay, we're gonna heat for an hour and then see how that goes. So I thought I'd take a quick look. Now, this is one of those mushrooms that truly needs that hour for that color to sink in. Some of them, like the Cordinarius, which you can get some Cordinarius smithii, you can get red from. Kind of gives you 90% of its color in that first sort of 10-15 minutes. And we're starting to get some colors, but we're really only gonna wanna give this dye that full hour, and we're gonna wanna leave it to set overnight in the bath as well. So we're gonna get our colors in total in the morning. Okay, let's see, the hour is up. Okay, We'll leave it to cool. Check on it later. Okay, it's the next morning. I've let it cool overnight in this jar. Let's see what colors we get out of here. So we have our three colors here. The paler one is the non-mordanted. The middle one is the alum mordanted, and this is the iron mordanted. And it's a little tough to see, but it's come out quite a, almost like a glaucous color. There's shades of green and blue and gray. I have another skein here. This was done with acorn, and you can really see next to more of a gray how much bluer and greener these ones came out. So there you go. What's worth dyeing with this mushroom to get this amazing, interesting color of blends of blue and green and gray. So after I finished that first round, I did what's called the first exhaust bath, which is another round with yarn. This is about 300 grams. So altogether, I did end up dyeing just under 400 grams of fiber with those 400 grams of mushrooms. So these are the colors you're getting with about a 1-to-1 ratio. So really strong dyer. If you're dyeing with dried Boletopsis, I would suggest 2-to-1. Also, I should mention that these dyes are considered stable and light fast. To take a second and show you the underneath so you get maybe a better sense of what I'm talking about. So here is your Boletopsis, and I'm going to try and use a hand lens if you can see. So there's the pores, tiny pore surfaces. And what's interesting is that you'd think that this would be in with the other mushrooms that are poured, but it's not. It's in this group, the Thelephoroids. And as you can see, this is the hydenellum. This is one of the hydenellums. And you can see that it has, maybe I'll just take that away, these teeth underneath. These are this pore surface. And I have a sarcodon here. And you can see again, it has that pore, those teeth for their pore surfaces. And here's another one, which is a guild. This is the polyocellus multiplex. So interesting that these are all related and yet they have such different pore structures. And it really shows you how much is changing the world of mushroom in terms of DNA analysis and putting stuff together. But you can't beat a good mushroom book. This is obviously a great one, Mushrooms Demystified. It is a little bit dated, so you do want to have a look and make sure that the names are taxonomically is correct. It's changed a bit, but it's still such a great resource.